VCon 2017. Thank you. I'm Kalai. Yes, I'm from, by birth, a Malaysian. By blood, an Indian. And the last 10 years, who I am today, and I give that credit today to the beautiful continent of Africa. And that is where I spent most of my last 10 years. My parents and grandparents came into this country because of poverty. They wanted a better life for the next generation. Love you too. And my dad, he's 75 now, and my mother is 70. Dad has never been to school, stood outside a school and learned how to read and write. Because they could not afford to put him in school, and he had to cut grass, feed the cows, so his brothers and sisters could eat. And my mom lost her mother when she was 8. She spent rest of her life in the kitchen taking care of brothers and sisters. So the only thing they knew is if they could give me all the education I needed, I could be the best I could be, and I could break from the poverty. I grew up believing if you're born poor, it's not your fault. But if you die poor, it's your fault. I was not raised to do business, or I was not raised to stand here to talk to people. I come from a typical background that I was raised a woman's voice should not be heard. You don't wear clothes that shows. I was forced to wear clothes that were oversized the whole my life because you should not be noticed. I grew up in an environment where my father and uncles sit in the sofa. I have to sit behind or sit on the floor. I was raised where in the kitchen, you stand and serve the man at home first. So I went on to get the highest possible education I could get. I'm an engineer by profession. And I did a master's in high voltage engineering. And I wanted to be among the first few female high voltage engineers in this country. So I walked into this environment by accident. I was invited by a very good looking guy in the university. Ladies, you know this. If you're single and you are young and a good-looking guy invites you, don't say no. So I did not say no to that invitation. He was really good-looking, white, mixed Indian, so too good to reject. When I sat in this environment the very first time in a presentation, I did not know that I wanted to do this. I did not know I could do this. I didn't know if this was for me. I didn't know it is possible. I didn't know I would even go anywhere with this. But all I knew at that point, I like how it felt. I liked how it felt. I liked the feeling being in this environment. I left the room that day and I said, I'm signing up to what I don't know. I signed up just because I like how it felt. Just because I like how it felt. If you at this point, we have been here, today is day 3. And if something in you says, you belong here. You like how it feels. You like already something about this feeling the last 2.5 days, how you feel. Keep on to that feeling. It can bring you very, very far. The day I signed up, my upline quit on me. That was the last day I saw my upline. And I've not seen my upline for the last 14 over years. The one who signed me up. And I did not quit simply because I liked how it felt. And secondly, I took a loan from my dad to get started in this business. Yes. But I was creative. I went to him and I said, Dad, I want to do a business. And I have all the money in the world I need. I'm just lack of $600. Can you give me a loan? And he said, are you sure you have all the money you need and you only lack of $600? And I said, yes, only $600. And I told him, it's a 3-month loan I need to give you back. And how could I quit when I probably took the last bit of money he probably had? So I had to figure out how to make this work. But I only knew one thing. I don't know how to present. I did not know how to do this business. And I had an advantage. I had an advantage. And my advantage was I knew nothing. I knew nothing about network marketing. Nothing. I did not know there was a business called network marketing. I did not know some people might not like it. I didn't know people had opinions about it. I did not know some were negative about it. And I did not know people have quit this business. So if you today, I want to tell you, even to begin, if you have any opinion, throw it outside. Throw it outside. Because those opinions are not going to help you. So I had an advantage. I call it my beginner's advantage, that I had no opinion. So when I saw the first time, I just saw this as something that could make a difference to me. That's it. I don't even know what, why, how, and everything. But all I knew, I had responsibility. I had responsibility. I needed to give back my dad and mom what they have sacrificed. My mom and dad sacrificed a lot beyond what I would not be able to do if I have a kid of my own. My mom and dad were willing to give me away to my uncle to be raised simply because they wanted me to have the best education. They believed my uncles and aunties were more educated than them, would be able to raise me as a more educated person than my mom and dad could. How many of you are a parent here today? How many of you are a parent? You have a child. How many of you have a child? Would you give it away to someone else to raise? But my mom and dad were willing to do that. And only my dad was willing to see me only over the weekends because he knew his love for me was, yes, his love was for me, was really about me being the best version that I could be. So I knew that I wanted to be somebody. I had a responsibility towards my parents, you know, but I did not know what I wanted to be. But I knew when I came here, this is what I liked. I liked how it felt. I liked how it felt. And I wanted this to be mine, this moment to be mine. So the second thing that I did right was to accept an invitation from a cute guy. The second thing I did right, what I stayed in this environment. I stayed. And I remember a speaker in an event said, if you don't know what you want, just catch on to something. Catch on to something. Catch on to something and hold it. And I told myself, I'm just going to catch on to something. And I remember I drove 9 hours for one of my first major events. I was south in Singapore, and I drove from Singapore right up to Penang in this very island for one event of QNET many years back. And that moment, I walked into the room after a 9-hour drive all by myself. And I walked in and the event just started. And the person who walked up on that stage that day is none other than we partner Donna Imsen. None other. Donna Imsen. She was so beautiful. She wore something red and black. She walked into this room so beautiful. The moment she walked in, the whole room just turned around. And I saw how she spoke, how people got excited, that energy, that excitement, everything. And I told myself, that's what I want. That's what I want. God, if you have a plan, I don't know what tomorrow holds for me, but I know who holds my tomorrow. I know you hold my tomorrow. But if you have a plan for me, let this be part of my plan. And that day, I told myself, I too want that spotlight a little bit on me, and I'm okay. I don't have to leave behind my brother, my uncles, and my father. I don't have to stand behind. I could walk at the front, and I could take the limelight. I could have the light. And I hold on, and I continued doing my work. I don't know anything else. They told me that's 8 basic building block. Great. 8 basic building block. They told me I need a dream. Yes, she is my dream. I need to commit. Yes, I am going to commit. I need to make a list. Yes, I made a list. I need to contact. I contacted. I need to present. I presented. I need to follow through. I followed through. I need to build a team. I build a team. I need to counsel. I counseled. And I need to duplicate. I duplicated. And sometime back, one of the top leaders of QNET today in the network leaders came to me and said, Kalai, I was sitting in this room many years back, and I did not know if I want to do this business. So I was sitting here and wondering, what's in for me? Then they called your name. You walked up on that stage. You took that stage, and your dress that day was so beautiful. You looked so beautiful. And that very moment, I knew I too wanted that spotlight on me. And she said, that was my click, that is my moment. And I know today, that woman, that beautiful lady today, is responsible for thousands and thousands of you holding on to a dream today. So I know for sure, if I hold on to something and I do my work, eventually I could transfer the same possibility to someone else. Someone else. I worked on this business. I had no idea. All I knew that at the end of every month when I was working, I had a reasonable good amount of salary. I had a house of my own when I was very young. I was not even 27, 26. I bought my first property. I had my own car. I was doing pretty okay for being a young engineer in this country. And then when I first decided to go all out and start working and continue doing what I had to do, suddenly, I started making my 1 month salary 4 times in a month in QNET. 4 times. My monthly salary as an engineer became my weekly income in QNET. And suddenly I woke up one day and I said, this is possible. 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 I went to my boss and I told him this. Boss, I need 3 months unpaid leave. He said, why? I said, I got family issues that I need to sort out in India. I wasn't even going to India. I said, I need 3 months. He said, what issues? I need to sort some issues out and I will take 3 months to come back. Good excuse. And he said, are you sure? Yes. I took 3 months unpaid leave. That third month, in 1 month, I clocked my 1 year salary in 1 month. In 1 month. It is then I knew it is possible. It is possible. And I don't have to go back to my office. And I did not go back. I did not go back. Only then I knew that I don't have to be an engineer and work to have what I want. I could be much more than what I thought it was possible. Let me tell you something very interesting. It is just, I was sometime back, many years back, I'm somehow, a lot of good accidents happened in my life. And I'm also a person that when I feel I want to do it, I don't think too much. I just do it. I just want to do it. And I remember VP Ranjit Singh, you heard him speak yesterday, asked me, can you pack your bags and follow me to India? Yes, I landed in Bangalore. Yes, it was my best moment in this journey. One of my best moments in that city, beautiful city of Bangalore. The PH Road Button Tower was my place every day. I did not have a single name on my name list, not a single name. And I asked VP Ranjit, what am I supposed to do? He said, present. I said, to who? He said, present. To who? Present. Okay, I need to present. So I just presented. I presented and presented and presented and presented and presented and presented. My tagline was very simple. Hi, I'm from Malaysia. I'm an engineer. I'm here to open a business. Can I have 15 minutes of time? I have a proposal. That's it. I presented. But what turned me around, I saw VP Ranjit was sitting with one guy. He was talking. And I was looking at him talking. I said, okay, he's presenting. Okay, I went out. I spoke to 20 people and came back. He's still talking to the same guy. I was like, he's talking. Okay, good. I went out. I presented to another 20 people and came back. He's still talking to the same guy. And I said, okay. The next day I woke up, I went out, presented. And he was presenting, talking to the same guy. I was like, the same guy? Okay, I went out. I came back in the evening. He's talking to the same guy. I went out. I presented. I came back. He was with the same guy. Next day I woke up. I looked at him. He looked at me. And I was wondering, is he going to do the same thing? So I went out and I collected, presented. And I came back. He was talking to the same guy. And he had one extra guy. I said, hoo-hoo, he has a prospect. Okay. I went out. I came back. He was presenting. I went out. I came back. He was talking to the same guy. I said, two. I went out. I came back. He spoke to the two guys. It happened for 4-5 days. I didn't understand. I was presenting, and there's some nights I almost wanted to vomit because I was talking that much. And he called me and said, can you help? I said, help? What help? Can you book a hall? Book a hall? He said, yes, book a hall. I said, 20, 30 people room? No, 400. 400 pax? He said, I'm paying, you know, you go book. Okay, I went and booked, and I was wondering, 400, because nobody said yes to me yet, so how 400 going to come? So I went on doing the same thing. I probably in 7 to 8 days would have spoken to 200 strangers in the city of Bangalore. Then the doors opened. In his room that day, he had 500 people. 500 people. And I told myself, if there's one thing that I want to learn in my life, is to turn one person to 500. And he said, Kalai, it is not about what you can do. It is about how many people around you. And I went, somehow along my journey, I ended up in Nigeria with one guy, few years after that. And I asked myself that I want to do that. And I started doing it. In the same 7 to 8 days, that one person became 500 in Nigeria. 500. And I remember the night I finished. All I did for 24 hours, non-stop signups. Then I knew at that point, if I hold on to something and I do my work, it is possible. 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 Let me tell you, I did, when I started this business, 90 presentations and nobody signed up. My first sign up was 96, 97 presentations. And it was my sister. The only reason she signed up is because she said, I feel so sorry for you. Every day you come back, you are excited. In the morning, you go out and you said you have presentation and you come back at night and I asked you who signed up and you said nobody. So the dialogue was the same. I will go out excited in the morning. Somebody is going to sign up today. And I go out, I present and I come back at night and she will ask me who signed up. Tomorrow. And the next day I will wake up and I get dressed up and I go out and I present and I say, somebody is signing up today. And I come back at night and she asks, who signed up? Tomorrow. And I go back tomorrow, the next day, dress up and present the plan. And then I come back and then she will ask me, who signed up? I said, tomorrow. And then it continued tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. And then she came to me and said, nah. I said, what? Take this money. I said, for what? Sign me up. I said, why? You know, if I'm your sister, I don't support you. Who will support you? Sign me up. Today, let me tell you something. There was a moment in a beautiful country called Uganda. I landed. Because I was on a tour and I told myself, I'm going to land and for 24 hours, I have some time in Uganda. I landed in the afternoon, 4 o'clock. I called my leaders at 6 o'clock and I said, I can do one presentation tomorrow. One presentation. One presentation. They said, okay, let's pull it off. One presentation, we send the messages. Let's see who comes. We will do the presentation. I said, okay, tomorrow is a working day. I said, it's okay. Let's do. I will just do what I can do. Then no problem. I got to fly out. They said, okay, let's do it. Presentation supposed to be at 4, 5 o'clock. At 4 o'clock, my friend that I met in Malaysia, my strongest filler in the continent, African continent today, Hajara, dropped me to the venue. So while we were driving, I asked her, Hajara, why all these people? Is there some concert or show happening in the city today? She said, Kalai, they are here to see you. They are here to see you. And we were driving and I asked her, can I put the mirror down? And I just want to enjoy this moment. I put the mirror down. And of course, they recognized me, and I started waving at them. And I walked into the hall. It was 3,500 people. There were many nights, when I saw TV at night, CNN, BBC, whatever it is, and I saw a gathering of Africans, on TV. I will call my sister, my entire family, and tell them, that's gonna be me one day. I'm gonna walk into one country one day, and I'm gonna walk up, and thousands of people will wait for me. And that day became a reality. And I know, just hold on to whatever that clicks here. Hold on. And keep doing the work. It is yours. And by doing this, over the years, I've given permission, or I've unknowingly gave that light to many people to hold on to something also. The same that you and I could do today. By us holding on to something and doing our work, we are also giving that someone else a chance to hold on to something. Just have to hold on. You know, many times people have asked me this question: how I keep myself excited, how I keep myself motivated, how I keep myself inspired. I don't know what else, where else, a better place to be than here. And then here. I don't know where else I could keep breaking my ceilings. I could keep climbing, and I could keep repeating the word, "It's possible." I don't know where else. Each time I come back to this place, each time I come back, I have something to catch on, to go out, and something to hold on to. I keep coming back. There's one thing that I did. The first blessing was I did not know about this industry. I didn't know it. I call it, it's a blessing. It's a curse to know about the industry, I think. So forget about whatever you know about the industry, and that's it. And the second thing is, it is to hold on. To hold on and to keep coming back. Let me tell you something. To whoever I am, to a certain extent, to a big extent, the person who really, I know, even this, I actually only realized much later in my life that the biggest influence actually in my life is my father. I did not know that for the longest time. I thought when I was growing up that dad didn't want to really have us with him or me with him, or it was a different setup. It is not the same when you know that in the house it's not father, mother, and me, my sister, and my brother, and there's so many other people, and you don't know why your dad only comes back at the weekend, and you don't know why. And then when you go to your relative's house and they tell you your dad loves you, and your dad talks about you all the time. I did not believe in that. I didn't believe in that. You see, my father, even though he never went to school, eventually he became a teacher. How? After learning how to read and write, he decided to dedicate his life to the kids in the village. And he has this younger sister of his, which was everything in his life. She's everything in his life. Like every brother, my father too wanted the best for her. So being a typical Indian family, big brother and the younger sister, my father did everything he could for her and found her the best perfect fit of a husband. You know, the perfect Indian fit. That you have a good job, good salary, good looking, you know, fair and don't know what, and good physique, good family, good relatives, everything. She got married and they had two beautiful kids. They are about similar age with me, two boys. And one morning, and I was in the house and dad was there, and he woke up and he just screamed, and I went into the hall and he said, "Your uncle died. His sister's husband died in an accident that morning." He said, "Pack your bags, we have to go." I saw my father cry next to his sister when she lost her husband when she was hardly in her 20s with a baby in her hand who was 6 months and a two-year-old boy next to her. I grew up watching my dad going through the pain that his perfect plan for his sister did not work out. And I don't know if is it because of that or what. My dad, only thing that he told me was, I want my daughters, me and my sister, to be what they want. Do what they want. Do what they want. You know, each time my mom would come back with some plans for me, he said, no, my daughters must be able to stand on their feet and ask for what they want, do what they want, get they want, have what they want. The biggest gift that I understood much later in life that my father gave me, he did not clip my wings. He did not clip my wings. In fact, he set me free. That is the only reason I was able to do what I did. He never stopped me from doing anything I wanted. I still remember I called him and I said, Dad, I want to do my master's and I got a scholarship. My mom cried. Said, why is she studying so much and who will marry her? Yeah, you know, this typical, normal conversations at home. And my dad said, I want her to do what she wants. I want her to do what she wants. Let her do. Even till today, when I go back and I sit with him and I talk to him, he only tells me, do what you want. Define your own happiness. Define your own happiness. Don't let anyone stop you from doing what you want. And I want to tell you, especially to the women in this room, if you're married, great. If you're not married, it's okay. If you have a loving husband, great. If you don't have, it's okay. If you have brothers and fathers supporting you, it is great. If you don't have, it is okay. If your parents with you today, it is great. If you don't have, it is okay. If you have a team with you in this room, it is great. If you're sitting here alone, it is okay. If your family is supporting you, it is great. But if you are alone today, it is okay. It is okay. It doesn't matter. You can be what you want to be as long as you make that decision. Make that decision and be what you want to be. Do not ever allow anybody to clip your wings. Be what you want to be. Because here, in this environment, it is possible. Thank you, guys. I love you. She's just a girl and she's on fire.